questions, like raise your hand. Like I said, this is about understanding. Right? This is not about argument, anything like that. It's not about anything else but trying to understand.
We good back there?
Yeah, we good.
Apologize, y'all. I know y'all got a bunch of information right there, so that was very good. So it's always all good, everything working out good. But it's important, we're going to deal with the importance of identifying. The reason I say true Israel, because that's a what? Speak that to me. I said that. The reason I say true Israel, because there's a what? False Israel, right? So a lot of times, your number one thing that you get, right? Especially when you go into family members, you find this information out, you're like, wow, man, this is awesome, you know? You thinking, you digging, you looking into it, and then you go tell somebody and they ain't got that same insight, and they're like, okay. Why is that important? What they got to do with Jesus? What's the point of all that? My identity is in Christ. I'm a new creature. I ain't got to worry about all that. That's what you hear. That's why most people start in the middle of the book. When you start in the middle of the book, you can't get the mindset of the creator of the book. If you started, like you're saying, in the middle of a movie, when you get to the end of the movie, you won't know what's going on. But if you start at the beginning, you'll understand everything. So this is why it's important. We're going to show you why it's important to identify Israel so you have an answer for these things. All right? So let's go. Number one, you just take the Bible. Just take the Bible. Right? I know the importance of something when I look at how much something is in a book. If I know the importance of a movie, of an actor, I see how many scenes he in. You have people that's in the movie and you just see them walk by and they're staying in. That ain't important. That don't matter. When you look at the books, the whole beginning, 39 books of the Bible, of the scriptures, it's all talking about Israel, from Genesis all the way to Malachi, right? Who is it talking about? Israel. From the time from Shem all the way down to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob. And when you get to that point, all the prophets is about Israel. So wouldn't that make Israel important?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So we know that some of the prophets prophesied some things that hadn't came to pass yet. So let's keep going. Not only that, the Gospels are historical accounts of who? Israelites. Am I right? The Gospels are historical accounts of Israelites, and Christ or the Messiah's dealings with Israel. Then you go to Acts. The book of Acts is a historical record of the Acts of the Apostles. Are the Apostles, were the Apostles Gentiles? No, it was Israel. Now we got from Genesis all the way to Acts, and who is talking about?
Israelites.
Israel. Y'all don't be scared to talk back to me. I'm like an interactive, okay? Don't get scared. You think your voice going to be on camera. They don't know who you are. You all right. I know you been slumped in this meeting. But let's keep going. So we see the Gospels and the books of Acts is about Israel, right? Mainly. Then you go to the book of Romans. Paul talking about Israel. A lot of people, when it comes to understanding the Messiah, they go straight to Paul. Is Paul the Messiah? So I have to go through the Messiah and cipher everything that everybody say from the Messiah words, right? Because he's the Messiah. He's the Mashiach. He's the one that we put our stamp on, right? So everything in the scriptures gonna tell you that Peter already told you that Paul say things that's what? Hard to be understood during their time. Now you fast forward 2,000 some years up to our time. Don't you think we'll misunderstand Paul?
Mm-hmm.
They had a foundation in Hebraic ways of life, and they still misunderstood Paul. We don't know nothing about the Hebrew way. We just woke up to it. Some of us 4, 5, 6, 7 years ago, right?
It's important because we can misunderstand what Paul said if we don't do diligent study and go back and study the Torah and see where he's coming from. Right?
Book of Romans, the book of James, the book of Hebrews, the book of Corinthians, and Revelation. So that's about, what, 85 to 90% of the book that's dealing with who?
The reason a person can ask why is this important when you deal with Israel is because they're ignorant to into the books of the Bible. Because anybody that really studies Israel, they'll understand that Israel is very important. Not just important to us. It ain't about if it's important to us. It's important to the Most High. Because if he don't come back and deal with what he said he was going to do with Israel, that would make him a lie, and we can't put our faith in. We might as well go do something else. Might as well go be Muslim or something. Right? Let's keep going. Now, let's look at what the Most High said. I don't care about what we say. I don't care about what none of us say. Let's see what he declared. Now, he's talking about end time.
Right.
Right?
Right. It's future prophecy.
It's future prophecy.
Right.
Stuff that ain't happened yet. Watch what he says now. He put his weight on this. Isaiah 66:22. Watch what it says. But as the new heavens, are we in the new heaven? No. And the new earth, are we in the new earth? Which I will make, right, shall remain before me, said the Most High. So shall what? Your seed and your name remain before me. Notice it didn't say, so shall you and your name. It said your seed. Because I'm dealing with what? Everybody in your generation. So Israel is not lost. They're scattered. So he said, if the new earth can be remain before me and the new heavens, long as they remain before me, so shall your generation remain before me. So ain't no Israel done away with. Ain't no Israel, it don't matter. Because he's still speaking of Israel when everything's over with. Am I right? Talk about telling us. Everybody say, come. That means yes in Hebrew. Y'all gotta wake up a little bit. Get your little office. Sit up. Come on. Here we go. Jeremiah 31. Watch this. 35-37. We're talking about end time prophecy. Watch what it says, bro. Thus says Yahuwah, thus says Yah, which giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinances of the moon of the stars for a light by night, which divided the sea when the waves thereof were. The Most High hosted his name. Watch this. Verse 37. If those ordinances depart from before me, said the Lord, then shall the seed of Israel also shall cease from being a nation before me forever. Now we see the sun out right now, right?
Right.
The moon ain't going nowhere when nighttime get here. So he said, if those two remain before me, which will forever remain before me, because they're subject to me, and they're doing what they purpose to do, we the only creation that don't do what we purpose to do. Said, if you can take that away, then you can take Israel from being a nation. It's powerful. That's the Creator talking.
Right.
So I'm going to listen to the Creator over anybody.
Yeah.
Am I talking right?
Yeah.
Watch what he says right here. Now, this is important. Now, watch this network. Thus says the Most High, even the heaven above can be measured, and the foundation of the earth searched out beneath. I will also cast off the seed of Israel and all them that they, Israel for all they have done. Now he said, if the heavens can be found out and the foundation of the earth, then I will get rid of Israel for what they did. So it ain't really mattering completely about what they did. He said, I still got a covenant with that. But watch this. Can we measure the galaxy?
No.
So he said, if the heavens can be measured, then you can cast Israel away. So we know the heavens can't be measured, right?
Right.
They would not be able to come up with no technology that can measure the galaxy. Right. He put it like that because he wanted there to be a witness to Israel being his seed.
Yeah.
Okay. The earth, the waters, it's parts of the ocean we can't understand and can never see, right?
Exactly.
We ain't got no technology to get all the way down to that way, 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 way below sea level, right?
Yeah.
They will never come up with some technology because that's a witness.
Yeah.
That Israel is going to forever stay before me. Y'all will never be able to search out that deep. Because if you search that out, then Israel ain't a nation before me no more.
Yeah.
This is what he's saying.
Right.
So he set the earth up to witness about you.
Right.
But you ain't important. You don't need to learn that. Just keep going on all these consequences and curses throughout your generation and you will be all right.
In this scripture right here, when it's talking about the witnesses, like it's about the witness of the earth. Now remember, when you read Paul.
just how you understand. The Bible says, line upon line, precept upon precept, right? So when Paul goes in the scripture when he says that how the earth groans in pain from the manifestation of the Son of God, this is what he's talking about. Because the earth is connected to Israel, right? We, I don't know if we're going to get to that, that scripture, but it's a scripture talking about how when Israel returns to their homeland, that, Israel, that the land becomes like a garden of Eden. The actual earth gives forth its own fruit for Israel, right? So it's connection with that. And then again, with the cosmos, we're talking about for the earth and for the living. But,
alright, so now we understand that? What I just talked about, Khan?
Khan.
Alright. Now let's see what the Messiah said. Let me show you what he said. This contradicts a lot of Christianity theology. That's what he said right here. He said, think not. Don't even think about that. He said, don't think. Think not that I come to destroy what?
Law.
Or who?
The prophets.
And I came not to destroy it, but to what?
Fulfill.
So now some people try to make that destroy and fulfill be the same word. Well, it ain't destroying it, but when you fulfill it, it just done away with it. But he said, watch what he said. He said, I didn't come to destroy the law or the prophets. Why would he say that? Because things that the prophet said hasn't all came to pass yet.
Right.
So he said, what I did, I came and served my purpose of gathering Israel and gathering, being that initiation that you're going to need in order to receive the promises of what the prophet said.
Right.
Now you have an opportunity to come back. You can't just come back the law.
Right.
You can't. You can't just come back to law because by your sinful nature, you sinful, you have to have your sins paid for. Mm-hmm. So when your sins are paid for or your gift offering is paid for, now you have taken on the Mashiach and you're standing in his authority, in his stead, now being able to receive every promise of what? What the prophet said.
Right.
That's why I said this child would be for the fall and the rise again of who? Israel. Just to add to that, verse 18, for verily I say unto you, till the heaven and the earth pass away, one jot and one tittle shall no way pass from the law, till all be fulfilled.
Any question? Has all the law been fulfilled yet?
Nope.
Okay.
So why are we talking crazy?
Exactly. And, you know, we, in our congregation, one thing we talk about a lot is who would be shot, sick.
Yeah.
Because Mashiach says what? In the beginning was, well, at general about Mashiach, he says, in the beginning was what?
The Word.
Word was what?
With God.
Was
God.
Later on in the Word became what?
Flesh.
What?
Dwelt
among. Okay, all right. So, now we talk about the word Word. Now, again, the King James translation. Now, that's what we call a Hebraism, a Hebrew idiom, right? So, anytime the Hebrews would say the word Word, what they meant was law and prophets. Right.
Yeah.
Because what the New Testament? What the New Testament?
Yeah.
You understand? Every time the apostles, there was no New Testament.
That's right.
Right. So that's the reason why you read the book of Acts. They talk about how they search the law and the prophets. It literally says that. Right. So the law and the prophets is the word.
Okay.
So when he says that in the beginning was the word, in the beginning was the Torah.
Okay.
The Torah was with Elohim.
Okay.
The Torah was. Goes on and on. The Torah became flesh. So this is the reason why you go to the book of Acts. Everybody talking about the day of Pentecost, right? The day of Pentecost is Shavuot in Hebrew. It's the celebration of the giving of
the law.
So his spirit came on the day of the holiday of the giving of the Torah.
Mm-hmm.
And he says what? Because it will what? Be written on your heart and on your mind. You understand me? He says what? I'll write the law upon your heart and upon your mind. So the purpose of the Mashiach was to give you his spirit so you could walk in the law.
In the law.
You understand me? Because into that deeper, but saying that to say, so there's no way he can do away with the law or the Torah, because he is the Torah.
That's
understand
right.
What I'm
he's
saying?
Away with himself.
He's doing himself.
Right. Now, we're not saying that you are saved by the law.
Right, right.
But walking out the law is my gratitude to the Creator for giving me salvation.
Mm.
That's how I walk apart. There's no way you can live a set-apart life because the Holy Spirit is going to make your life walk the law out.
Right.
Is it hard not to walk in homosexuality? Can that not be done? We cannot walk in homosexuality.
Exactly.
Right.
So you can't live that out. You can live that out.
Not kill your neighbor.
Right.
Is that hard to do? I gotta kill my neighbor. It's too much, right? I mean, it's just, it kind of gets silly when you think about it. I mean, because people want to, they want to defend the commandments, and they want to say that you don't have to kill the law.
Exactly. Then they tell you to keep the law of the land, though. You keep America law of the land, but the kingdom ain't got no laws. And then they say, well, the Messiah bought a new law. But let's see what he said. John 12 and 48. He who rejects me and does not receive my sayings as one who judges him, the word I spoke is what will judge him at the last day. For I did not what? Speak my own initiative or words, but the Father himself who sent me has given me a commandment as to what to say, what to speak. I know that his commandment is eternal. Therefore, things that I speak just as what the Father has told me. So what the Father said up was eternal. That makes sense?
Yes.
Keep going. Now, we understand that. It says, let's look at did the Most High choose the people? Because we're talking about the importance of identifying.
Yeah.
Let's see if he chose the people. We're almost through this section. Deuteronomy 7 and 6, but thou art what? An holy people unto Yah, thy God. God has what? Chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are born on the face of the earth. Did I say that? Why do you think he put scriptures like that in the scriptures? Because he knew it was going to be a people on the earth that are taught that they are nothing. They talk that their skin is nasty. They talk that their facial features are nothing. So he had to put some in the scriptures down the line to let you know you're special. God picked the lowliest of people and can do what? Confound the wise. So this why is important because we all do the same thing. I like this shirt I got on. Chosen. Went to the store. One thing about me, when I find a shirt, you're going to see it once a week a little bit because I chose that shirt and I like it above the other shirts in my closet. That is not talking about a superiority, trying to make somebody else feel bad. But the Most High was showing that I set you apart. I gave you my heart and my mind, which made you what? Special. Now, you don't go and demean nobody else because you already been demeaned, so you know how that feels. Right. But I want your confidence level up so I can walk in you to be that example of the chosen that I developed from the foundations of the earth. Right?
Right.
Amos 3, 1 and 2. Hear this word that the Most High has spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family which I bought from out of the land of Egypt, saying, you only have I known of all the families of the earth. Why would he make that statement?
That's a powerful statement.
Say it again. He said a little louder.
A little louder. He only had what a covenant with us. To know somebody is to what? Have fellowship and intimacy. So this nation right here, I'm giving you my mind and my heart that lets you know me closer. That's going to do what? Draw all nations to me. Because they're going to look at you, how I deal with you, and want to do what? Give up their gods. Because he could have came down and just made everybody his people and knocked all the gods out. He said, no, I want you to choose me. So I'm going to pick a people in the earth, manifest my power, manifest my way, to have you give up your gods and come unto me. Well, our crazy behind here, the opposite. We gave up our God and went to these crazy gods over here, wood and stone. Ain't that crazy? Psalms 147, this is going to verify, 147, 19 and 20. He showed up his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto the children of Israel. He has not dealt so with any other nation, and for his judgments they have not known them. This is why Israel was kings and priests in the earth, because they were supposed to, through those commandments and through those statutes, are used to draw all nations unto him. It's never just about Israel, or he would have chose Israel and killed everybody else.
Right. Oh, no. I was just saying that this is one reason why you have a hard time dealing with people and reform theology, or theology in general, teaching churches and stuff. Because, as you see right here, it says, he have not dealt with so with any nation. As for his judgments, that's the scriptures and everything he teaches, they have not known. So when you go to people, you're like, hey, look, you know, open up these scriptures. Like, man, I'm like, I'm 1960. What are you talking about? Not necessarily to my, but then our people, you know, outside of our people, to people that are gatekeepers in Christian circles, if you understand what I'm saying. This is absolutely foolish to them. When you start talking about this thing, they can't even grasp that. That's why we had a documentary called Reformed Apologetics Destroyed on YouTube. Because it's an apologist. And he spent all his time, I mean, trying to supposedly counteract everything that we've been talking about. And they would use scriptures like Moses. Like, one thing that really stood out to me in his documentary was he tried to say that the Israelites were racist. They didn't like blacks. But this is the kind of mindset that these people have. I'm not talking about people that teach these doctrines. You know what I'm saying? I'm talking about the people. The doctrines that they teach, that's the kind of things they say in their seminaries. That's why you got doctrines like the Hamite curse. They say that all black people are cursed because Ham saw Noah naked. Even though that's not a thing, because it's not in the Bible. Ham was never cursed in scripture.
Seminary
is
a cemetery.
Wait, I'm sorry.
And I understand a lot of the reform apologists, you know, they feel like they got to get on things because of the camps. And the camps gave us a bad representation.
Yeah.
They on the corner, cussing, fussing, white man, ain't no salvation, devil, get out of here, all that type of craziness. That has made us look, if you identify with that, you crazy. You see what I'm saying? And I understand that aspect, and I understand why they have to come against those guys. Not all camps are like that, but a lot of them are. That's giving us a bad name. So I don't see nothing wrong with them standing up against them because of the wrong portrayal they're trying to have of the scriptures. But when you come against our heritage, then you bring all of us in there.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And we all got to come at you then. All you have to do, go to YouTube and put in Black Hebrew Israelites. And those are the guys that are on the corner, you know, with their, I don't want to keep calling them Power Rangers outfits. I don't want to call that. Because, you know, they're embracing their culture and things like that. They really try to embody it. So I don't want to say Power Rangers. I ain't throwing no shots.
They really. They got the Earth, Wind, Fire outfit.
The Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Grandmaster.
Man. But you go on there and you'll find out who they are, you know, some of them. But, you know, I'm not going to, you know, I'm going to admit, I have learned some things from them as far as their militants in the sense of study of the scripture, how they get their people to really understand it and make sure you know when they have Bible studies, they're making sure you understand where to go to this, how you find this, what you're going to do when somebody challenges you on that. I love that part of it. It's just the hatred part and the crazy part and the cussing part and all.
If they just stay in the classroom, we be all right.
Don't come out of the classroom. Okay. Deuteronomy 30:29. We're going to skip this. It says, the Lord's, the Most High's portion is his people. Jacob, he's saying this now. He said his portion, I'm going to get my portion out of the group. This portion right here is going to be mine. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance, so he inherited us.
Right.
He was found him in the desert land in a waste hollow wilderness, and he led him about and instructed him and did what? Kept him as what? The apple of his eye. That means his eyes was continually toward Israel. When you really understand the Most High's pursuit of Israel, there's no way you can say this not important. You still the apple of his eye right now.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You ain't been replaced. All right, so let's look at this real quick. Deuteronomy 4, 5, and 8. Let's start at verse 6. What I start at verse 5. Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments, even the Most High commanded me that ye should do these also in the land where you should go and possess. Keep therefore and do what? Do them. For this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations. So the scriptures is our wisdom and our understanding in the sight of the nations. Not Beyonce, sisters. You learn Beyonce philosophy over here. Girls, girls, girls rule the world. No. You got to find another culture to go with that one. Men, our statues and understanding is not Young Thug, Lil Wayne, Kobe Bryant. No. That ain't our philosophy. These are our statues and laws. This is how we're supposed to govern ourselves as a people. Right?
going. Now, we looked at that. We looked at the Most High talking about his people. We looked at the books of the Bible. Now let's look at the covenants. The covenants in the Bible. You have the Adamic or the Edenic covenant, the Noahidic covenant, the Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic covenant, the regathering of the land covenant, the Davidic covenant, and the new covenant. All we hear about is the old and the new covenant. That's all I hear. There's more covenants than that. But look, two of these is, what is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 in all. Two of them is with all the sons of Adam. But the rest five, the other five of them deals with the seed of Israel. So if only two is about all the sons of Adam, and the rest of them is about all the seed of Israel, that will let you know that Israel is what? Important. And in these covenants, there are prophecies in the covenant, there are terms and conditions in the covenant, there are agreements in the covenant, and there are blessings and cursings in a covenant. And all of these covenants overlap each other and has to be completely fulfilled. That did the Abrahamic covenant do away with the Mosaic covenant? Mm-mm. Did the regathering covenant do away with the Mosaic covenant? No. Did the Davidic covenant do away with the regathering covenant? No. Did the new covenant do away with all these covenants? No. Because there are prophecies in these covenants that must be fulfilled. Heaven and earth is not going to go away until what? All be fulfilled.
Right.
And there's no way that you can say that all was fulfilled in 70 AD. You done lost your mind.
Right.
But the Messiah consummated all these covenants. What did that mean? He gave the opportunity for us to experience the promises of all these covenants. Right? Let me ask you something. In Adam covenant, there was a conditional and unconditional term.
Right.
What did he say in the Garden of Eden? Don't eat of what? The tree.
Right.
Of the garden, or, you know, the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He said, the day you do that, you're going to surely die. Now, the rest of these you can eat, but don't do this. Keep the land, do all these type of stuff. What did he do? He ate it. The curses come.
Yep.
Right? All right, so watch this. The Messiah came, he died, was resurrected. Did that stop the curses in Adam?
Nope.
Now, the covenant with Adam, that was with Adam and everybody that was in Adam. Why do we say that? Because all of us experienced these curses of Adam, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. The with Noah, that covenant was with Noah and everybody that was in Noah. With Noah, three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Watch this. The covenant with Abraham, that was with Abraham and all of Abraham's seed, right? Mm-hmm. And there's promises in Abraham that even the Gentiles can get, because it said that through Abraham's seed that everybody in all the lands was going to get blessed, right?
Right.
The next covenant is the Mosaic covenant. That was with everybody that was in what? In Israel.
Okay.
Everybody in Israel experienced these. Same thing with the regathering, same thing with David, same thing down to the new covenant. So we see, because of the Messiah came, that doesn't mean that all these curses. Are women still having pain, having babies?
Yes.
Was there some pain? Or did you get delivered? We still working by the sweat of our brow, ain't we, bro?
Mm-hmm.
It's hard out there, ain't
it? Yes.
We still working. So what happened? Christ came and he paid for the penalty of our sin. He gave us power to live over, so this sin nature can't completely control us. But when he returns, he's going to take us away from the presence of sin. When the presence of sin leaves, that means you won't have no hurt, no pain, no more. None of these things. Everything cursed that came in Adam will be gone. So, hallelujah. Mm-hmm. So that let me know. You can't say that, well, Christ came, and then if you still believe you're under the curse, then you in your sin. Wait a minute. Well, you're still under Adam curse. The rainbow is still in the sky.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
So Mosaic, or the children of Israel, curses are still what? On them until they come into the Messiah.
Yeah.
and learn how to live over these things and get in right alignment. Then the only thing that will be taken from you is your rulership is suspended until the Mashiach comes back. You see what I'm saying?
Yep.
But all these things are contained and happen. Does that make sense? So if somebody tell you, well, we've been redeemed from the curse of the law. You've been redeemed, but you ain't been taken away. Because the presence of sin is still here. So sin still have curses and consequences that are in each one of these covenants that have been broken. Your initiation of the Messiah prepares you for when he returns, you'll get every promise that the prophets prophesied within these covenants.
Right.
That makes sense. Am I talking crazy?
Yeah. Speaking of this Mosaic covenant, and it's like the was talking about people being inside of you and those things falling upon them people. When the Mosaic came, which is covenant came, which is Deuteronomy 28, you know, you read about the stipulations, right? These things only happen to one people.
Right. Right.
Was everybody, do we got any kind of evidence of Caucasians being shipped on four corners of the earth on slave ships going into captivity?
No.
Do we got evidence of Egyptians going on four corners of the earth shipped on captivity? Anybody? Germans? Anybody? No. Nobody. Just us. So when these things happen, this is the sign. As a matter of fact, we read those stipulations, we'll find out it says that it was a sign upon us forever.
Yeah.
So when you think about these things, captivity, slavery, oppression, all these things are going to be a people, they're going to be the poster children.
That's right.
And that's how you're going to identify these people who are with this covenant. So these people got to be set up. So these people can have a shot to get this thing. You know what I'm saying? If these people are not put back in the right covenant, these people can't receive anything either. So this is another reason why this is so important.
Right? Let's look at the covenant with the seed of Israel. We're going to skim through these things and go pretty fast. All right. Let's look at our y'all. The Elohim y'all. Psalms 89:33-36 says, nevertheless, my loving kindness will now not utterly take from him nor suffer. So there's no way that you can say Israel don't matter when he said, I don't alter my covenant. It's things that I said about them that has to come to fruition. You see what I'm saying? Same thing, Numbers 23:19. God is not a man that he should lie, neither is the son of man that he should repent. If he has said it, and will he not do it? Or if he has spoken it, will he not make it good? I'm not going to pick a people, promise them something, and they break my covenant, scatter them, and be done away with. When you got all the prophets saying that if you're in the outermost part of the earth, I'm going to find you, I'm going to search for you, and I'm going to bring you back to the land and give you all the promises that I gave to your forefathers and multiply you. Did that happen? Mm-mm. We can't look at 1948. I got a whole teaching on that. 1948, and that's a joke.
Just going back to what you said. We have Jewish people in America, right? You say they will catch you from the four corners of the earth and bring them, right? So why are they still in America? Why are they still in Europe? Why ain't there all these other places? Why not all in Israel? According to the prophecy, they will all be gathered, right?
All be gathered. And it said it won't be no war no more in Isaiah 2. War over there, just crazy war. But you read Joel and you'll see why that war going on. Because he said, when I began to turn the captivity of my people, that means bring them back from captivity. First, I got to take them out of the captivity of their mind. So I got to release what? Bondage out of their mind and what they're learning in their captivities. He said, as I'm doing that, I'm going to get all them nations.
Yeah.
They did that. This is why you're starting to see the nations that had a covenant with each other, they starting to fight each other.
Yeah.
Be in disarray. So don't think you ain't got nothing to do with Jerusalem or what's going on there. All that stuff, these nations that's coming against, he said, I'm going to bring all these nations, I'm going to bring the original. And I'm going to come at them. Because what they have done to my people and my land. He said that.
Right.
Joel 3. Let's keep going. So, all us really know about the covenant that he made with Israel, we know Deuteronomy 28, the first 14 verses is what? The blessings.
Right.
Verse 15 on down is what? The curse. So he gave them a movie screen of what would happen to them if they break this covenant. He said, I want you above only. I want to do all this. I want to bless you. I want to give you everything. I want you to give you everything. And he had that at one point. But it said, if you mess up, let me show you this movie screen. I'm going to show you a big movie of all this stuff that's going to happen to you and your generation. Now, I'm letting y'all know, y'all making a covenant with not just with me, with those that are here. But those that are not here too, with your seed. All right? Deuteronomy 29 and 10, it says, you stand here this day, all of you before the Most High, your captains, your tribes, your elders, your officers, with all the men of Israel, your little ones, your wives, the stranger that is in that camp, from the hood of the wood and the draw of the water. Now the stranger came into covenant,
right?
Yep.
The same time as Israel. Some of us might be the children of the stranger.
That's real.
Right.
Because they came into what? Covenant.
Yep.
That's how I know everybody that was on that ship had come into covenant with the Most High somewhere in their generation.
Right.
Because the Most High would be unrighteous to whoop somebody he ain't never come in covenant with.
Mm.
So they might not, they might have been Muslim, they might have been, their faith might have been Muslim, this right there, some of this right there, but somewhere in their generation, their forefathers came into covenant, as we see here, the stranger also did too.
Right.
That makes sense? That thou should enter into the covenant with the Most High and into the oath of the Lord, verse 13, that he may establish the day for a people unto him something. He may be unto thee a God as he hath sworn to his father Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Verse 14, neither with you only do I make this covenant and this oath, but with him that standeth here and him that is not here, letting you know when I make a covenant with you, I go throughout your lineage and throughout your generations. I'm not just speaking to you, but all the people in this room were standing there at Mount Sinai at the time. All of us. Was standing there, Matt, with my, because our forefathers were standing there also, too.
Mm.
He said, I made this covenant with you, that those that are here, and those that are not here. That's why the scripture says that Levi got credit for paying tithes when he was in the loins of his father Abraham, when Abraham gave to Melchizedek. And Levi wasn't even his next child.
Right.
Mm.
That was all the way down to Jacob and the 12 tribes, but Levi got credit, because he was the priest. You don't know what priest you have in your womb right now. You don't have know what priest that you have within you right now. That's why we have to be careful about every decision. You don't make a decision off the now. You make a decision based off your legacy.
Yeah.
Mm.
So I can't move for the moment. I got to think before I do something. Why? Because I might hinder my generation. I might hinder my legacy.
Mm-hmm.
So it's important for me to be watchful and to think about what I show my generation.
That's right.
That's in front of me and that's still within me. Romans 28:45-46. We know this.
Right.
These curses shall come upon thee. What else they gonna do?
Overtake you.
I mean, wherever you go, even if you ain't on the land, it's coming. So you break this covenant.
You gonna watch these apologists. This is their thing. They gonna say, well, all that stuff. Who's the field of Babylon? It's Syria. This is a field here. This is a field here. He says these things gonna do what?
Pursue.
So that means that wherever you are, whatever time period you are, if you unite the covenant, these things gonna catch you. So that's the reason why we see through history, it just kept having over and over and over again. One thing that Morris brings up is before they even got settled in the land, there was captivities happening because of their disobedience, right? So this is a constant thing that happened to the children of the Most High. Again, because they said these things gonna be a sign upon thee and a wonder for 2,000 years. 8 months.
Forever.
7 years.
Forever.
Three captivities.
Forever.
Right? So, you track it down through the generation, we see these things continually to happen.
That's right. And then that lets you know, somebody tell you that that's been fulfilled in the scripture. Why would it have to be fulfilled in the scripture? So we can look at the evidence and know it happened.
Right.
So, Most High ain't going to wait from that time all the way down to transatlantic slave trade to start fulfilling that.
Right.
He's going to start doing it. The first place he fulfilled it was not Assyria. First place he fulfilled it was in the book of Judges. Read Judges chapter 2, chapter 6, chapter 8, and you will see every time Israel messed up, God stick for the nation that came in and spanked them. It was in captivity 18 years, 16 years, 8 years, 20 years. Right when in the book of Judges, right after Sinai, that they came into the land and started messing up, that's when it started. Not Assyria, not Babylon. That lets you know that this is not just a one-time, two-time fulfillment. This happened throughout your generation. To what Christ prophesied, what? The last captivity in Luke 21.
Mm.
Because all these other captivities had already happened before Christ came on the scene. He said, I see another one that you're going to be removed into all the nations of the earth, and the Gentiles going to trample down, what? Jerusalem. That's in Luke 21.
And going on that too, this is the concept of the gospel. So when you think about that, you think about all these captivities, you think about all this, like I said, by them being trampled down by the Gentiles, and Jews being trampled down by the Gentiles, and all these bad things happen. So that's why the gospel is to the people. When you read the context what Christ said. He said the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and preach the gospel to those that are poor, to those that are bound, to those that are in prison.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying? Because the Israelites were constantly under, during his time when he walked, it was under the captivity of the Romans and the Edomites. Right? So the Israelites for like years, thousands of years, have been in the captivity of under rule of other nations. So the gospel is to bring them out of that, to bring them back into covenant, to restore them to who they were, right?
That's right. Better let you know who the gospel was true first. It's the power unto salvation. Now we stop right there. Gotta preach right there. I believe in the gospel. It's in the power of salvation. Hallelujah.
In the next verse.
And that verse say what? The order. To the Israelite first. Then to me. And when you see when Christ came on the scene, he started preaching what? The gospel of Christ? He taught the gospel of the kingdom. The gospel of Christ is your initiation into the kingdom. But he came preaching what? The gospel of the kingdom. We got going on the page. We got a thorough video to show you what the gospel of the kingdom is.
Right.
Now, I had to put in my mind, okay, if I'm identified Israel, I got to see who was under the blessing and who was under the curse. Because before, when I was ignorant, I had said, well, shoot, them Jewish people, they look like they're the people now, because they blessed above my own people. They run everything. It says, well, if they blessed, they curse. And I look at Daniel 9, verse 9, and just to paraphrase, it says, therefore, the curse is poured upon us in the oath that is written in the law of Moses, the servant of our God, because we have sinned against him. So that's when I looked it up and seen what identifies the people. Because he knew that there was going to be mixtures. He knew that they was going to come in and ravage the women, do all this type of stuff. But he said, I'm going to give you a more sure word of prophecy that's going to do better than DNA.
Okay, right.
Because you can't just go with their DNA because they're the same people that didn't want to know who you to know who you are.
Right.
So you send some spitter off to them and you just trust them.
Right.
And they give you 30 countries in Africa. See what I'm saying? Now you can't, I'm not saying you can't look at it. Because a lot of it does go back to the Igbo people or the Ashanti people that would verify who we are. But I'm saying, if you can't put your full weight on that, I put my full weight on prophecy.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I let that be added to it. All right? So we see that there was a scattering. So now we know there's a people that are under the curse. Now, if I knew somebody, if I'm a doctor, and I can see visible signs on you that you have AIDS, I can see it all over you, all the signs and all these things. I would be a wicked doctor not to tell you the disease you have and give you the cure.
Okay.
I would be a wicked doctor to just allow you to say me telling you what your disease is not important. Mm-hmm. Everybody see that people, black folks, is a problem.
Yes, right.
We got problems, we got circumstances, we got situations. Yeah. But when you try to fix us, oh, you racist now. It's about the gospel. It's about everybody. You say the only problem. You say we have. You say somebody need to do something with them. But when somebody try to do something with them,
yeah.
You say, exactly. No, yeah. That ain't Jesus. Being by one people. So if I see the disease that are on my people and know the reason why it happened, wouldn't it be important for me to diagnose them, to show them that disease, in order to pull them out of those curses? That'd be very important. I'll be wicked not to.
That's right.
And I can tell you what your problem is and why this is happening, according to the scripture. And this is do what? Build our faith in the scripture.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Because ain't nobody in Kemetic or Egyptology ever told us why we came, why our nation was broke down. What happened with our God,
exactly.
Why we came over here on slave ships, and what's going to be our redemption.
Yeah.
That ain't on no Egyptian wall.
Right.
Ain't on no committed wall.
Sure.
Period. So I ain't got to know if Abraham was real, if Moses was real, if the Messiah was real. I'm real.
Yeah.
Because I'm seeing this.
Right. Right.
Prophetically happening. So we know that there was a scattering, they messed up. Ezekiel 36 and 19, I was scattered down among the heathen, first them throughout the country, Deuteronomy 28 and 25. The Most High shall cause them to be smitten by their enemies and will remove them into all the kingdoms of the earth. Because I know this,
And then I know that it's going to be a blessing upon them. It says, when all these things have come upon you, Deuteronomy 30, 1 through 5, I'm going pretty fast, because we over time. Deuteronomy 30, 1 through 5, it says, it shall come to pass when all these things have come upon you, the blessing and what?
The curse.
We have experienced the blessing during who times? David's time. And experienced the curse all the way through. He said, and set before you that thou shalt call them a mind among all these nations where the Lord God has driven thee. So we know that they're scattered. And what we are doing now, calling them to mind. I shall return unto thee, and you shall obey my voice according to all that I command you this day, and thou and thy children, with all thy heart and with all thy soul, that then the Lord God will turn your captivity and have compassion upon thee, and will return and gather thee from all the nations where the Lord God have driven thee. So if he don't do that, he's a what?
Liar.
So it's important for us to identify Israel because of they are under the curses, they've been scattered, and the promise that he gave to them. That you're not going to stay in your captivity. So every issue that you have under these captivities can all be explained and it put you right back in righteousness. Because a lot of us, even before we knew this, we struggled. Because religion, we struggled in religion. We did. But then we got this understanding from a cultural aspect and a scripture aspect. A lot of stuff we just started getting right in alignment. And it wasn't no struggle.
Go ahead.
We're just like, okay. I'm supposed to do this? Oh, okay, let's cut all that out. We're supposed to do that? There wasn't no fight. That's why I embraced the cultural. Because we have the only culture that the Creator gave Earth. Mm. This is the last reason. Deuteronomy 32 and 26 through 33. I love this scripture here. It says, I will have annihilated them who scattered, wiping out even the memory of them from the earth. Ain't that some strong words?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now that seems harsh, but we don't know how serious a covenant is with God.
Right. Mm-hmm.
We used to make a contract, break them all the time. So we used to, our culture in America, contract, boom, boom, break, ain't no big deal. But when you, in ancient times, I said a covenant was with a people and a covenant was with a God, and the same thing the Indians. It blew the Indians away when they made a covenant with some of the Europeans, right? And they broke it. They looking like, we don't operate like that. And some of the times when you see this, those armies that came against the Indian, you see an Indian that was standing up like this right here, riding on his horse and going like that, we just think that's a sign. That's a sign of saying we declare war because you broke this covenant. So we coming at you with all the power of everybody that was in covenant with us. Those were signs of a covenant because they knew how serious a covenant was with a brother and a covenant was with a God. Watch this. But I fear that the tongue of Israel's enemy who might misunderstand and say, what? Our own power has triumphed. The Lord had nothing to do with this.
Uh-oh.
But Israel is a sense. This is why. He said, I don't want Israel's enemy saying that it's by our power and our might that we did this.
Yeah.
They God ain't got nothing to do with it. Most I said, but Israel is a senseless nation, which is true. The people are foolish, which is true. Without understanding, which is true. Oh, that they would be wise and could understand this.
Yeah.
Oh, that they might know their fate. Mm-hmm. How could one person chase 1,000 of them and two people put 10,000 of them aflight? How could they come over there in Africa and the little nation come and take over the old kingdom and ship them all over the world for 300 and some years? How's that possible? If it wasn't no God intervention that said, I gave you up. Watch what it says. Oh, that they might know their faith. How could one person chase 1,000 of them, two people chase 10,000 of them to flight, unless their rock had sold them, unless their God had given them gold? Powerful right now. That explains everything. This is how a nation that can come in there and destroy your whole kingdom, not just your kingdom, but your seed.
Right.
And have the power to do that. And guess what? They knew it. They knew that they could have power over us because we broke a covenant. It empowered them and they knew it. It's in their records. They said it.
Mm-hmm.
They said these people are supposed to be under continual servanthood because they broke their covenant with their God that empowered us.
I'm just saying, well, when you talk about the Arabs.
Yeah.
When the first people settled was the Arabs. That's right. That's what they said. They called them the Yehudi, people of the book.
Okay, yeah. Mm.
Right? They said they under a curse. That's the reason why they went looking for them, for the people that was under the curse. Except when we came to America, they came up with a new curse. It's called the Amite curse. That was the reason why we were enslaved. That was taught in all the seminaries and then to this day. It was also come out of the Jewish people's faith and their writings. It's called the Talmud. Y'all got it.
So we can see that. We can see God's dealing with us is important. And all the prophecies and speaking was about Israel. So how could identify them not be important? Because they spoke prophecies over their life that would surpass their life and their generation to get all the way down to us and them. Yahushua, or some say Yeshaya, or some say Yahushua, came to redeem Israel. His purpose initially first was for Israel. John 4:21-23. Yeshua said unto her, woman, believe not. He said down, we're going to drop down. He said, for salvation is of the Yahudim. Matthew 15:24, he said, but I answered and said to them, I'm not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Acts 5:31, him have the Most High exalted with his right hand, prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. Repentance to who? Israel and forgiveness of sins. Galatians 4:4-5, but when the fullness of time was come, Yahuwah sent forth his son and made under the law to redeem them that was under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. Romans 9:4-5, who are Israelites who pertain to the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the service of God, the promises, who are the fathers of whom concerning the flesh Christ came, who is over all, God bless forever. Amen. So we see his focus was to Israel first, right? Because if I got a business and I put y'all in charge and I say I'm going to be gone for about 3 years, I give y'all guidelines of my business, how to operate the business for this business to work, right? Y'all take the business and do what you want to do. Y'all going down the street, selling what you want to sell, setting your own prices and doing everything. And I come back now, the business is broken, everything is bad. Well, I come back and come at all y'all customers. I'm going to come at who? The employees. Because I gave the employees specific instructions that they messed up on. This is why when the Messiah came, he had to come to Israel first. Israel messed up. And then he was going to get the rest of the nations together. Right? We may decide to look at Paul. People talk about Paul. Let's see what Paul said about the courts of the Israelites. Romans 1:16, we know about the gospel. He said it's to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Let's look at Romans 2. A lot of people don't deal with Romans 2. What he said, this is powerful. He said, for he rendered, and this is talking about judgment. He said, for he rendered, Romans 2:6, for he rendered to every man according to his works. To those who are patient, persistent, and well-doing, seek to be glory, honor, and eternal blessing of immortality, he will give eternal life. This is the Amplified version. Verse 8, but for those that are self-seeking, self-willed, and disobedient to the truth, responsive to wickedness, there will be indignation and wrath. He said, and there will be tribulation, watch this, anguish and calamity and constraint for every soul of man who habitually does evil. Watch the order. To the Jew or the Israelite first, and then also to the Gentiles. But glory, honor, and peace shall be awarded to those that habitually does good. Watch the order again. To the Israelite first and to the Gentiles. So we're going to get what? Our judgment first when we do bad. Right. And we're going to get our blessings first when we do good. This is why it says judgment starts where? First where? Because it's an order. Three. So what is the advantage remains of the Jew? How is he favored? Or what is his value or benefit of circumcision? Much in every way, chiefly because dead unto them were committed to oracles of God. Romans 11, we all know that. It says he ain't cast away his people. And you can read Romans 11 all the way down to get a full understanding of what Paul is saying. We'll hit some of the harder scriptures before Paul said later. Now the book ends in Revelation talking about Israel. He says in Revelation 7 that he's going to seal all the 12 tribes of Israel first, 144,000 and their families. But you tell me Israel ain't important no more, but he's going to seal them before anybody. Revelation 21:11-12. The new Jerusalem, the 12 gates are going to have what? It ain't just say nations like the Romans or, you know, the Assyrians, the Babylonians, the Americans. It said it's going to have the 12 tribes of Israel on every gate, letting you know they are still in war. The
But that makes sense. And that's pretty much the end of it. So we know that important because all the scripture in the Bibles is 80 to 90% of the Bible was written to them. We know that the covenants was the five. There were seven covenants, but five of them was made to Israel. We know they are still being fulfilled now. We know that that they made a covenant with the Creator, and we know that they broke the covenant. Now they're experiencing the consequences and the promises that He said He was going to do when they return to His covenant. They need to know that and need to understand that so they can come out of this unrighteousness. Because these things are upon them first, then over to all the Gentiles. And then the next thing, you know, the Messiah, He first came to them trying to get them straight. Then we know all the prophets' prophecies was to them, trying to tell them what their outcome was going to be. All these reasons is why they're important. And then we see Paul is talking about how important they was in his books. And then the book ends talking about who? Israel. So these are all the reasons why identifying Israel is extremely important, not to us, but to the Creator. Because if He don't do what He promised, then He's a what? Lie. And we should serve another God. Does that make sense? Is that clear? Did that help you?
Yes, sir.
All right, so we're going to take a break. What time is it now?
12:35.
We take a break. We take maybe a 30-minute break if you want to go get something to eat or something like that. And then we'll come back at about 1:15, 1:30 and get started again. Okay. That's all right? That was pretty good, family?
Great. Yes, sir.
And if you have to go, please don't leave without coming to us. Because if you have to go real quick, we want to get like a little interview of you just saying about the tour of what you know, just thinking about, you know, just giving your accolades and stuff about the tour, how good it was for the next tour that we're going to. That's what I